Okay, so before going to the examination of varicose veins, we'll have to look at some theory so we'll understand the examination better. So what happens in varicose vein is we basically get superficial, dilated and tortuous veins. So what happens here? So we can look at the lower limb venous system. So this will be the superficial vein and the deep veins. So these are the valves. Okay, these are the valves. So it allows blood to flow in a single direction. So the valves will prevent the backflow of blood. So it makes sure that when the calf muscle soleus contracts, it only pushes the blood and eventually into back into the cardiovascular system. So it is a function of the valves. So superficial vein, deep vein, and what we have as the interconnecting structure is what we call as the perforating veins or the perforators. Okay, so if there's a valve incompetency, meaning if the valve isn't working or functioning well, there'll be a backflow of blood due to gravitation. So what will happen is, instead of the blood moving in one direction from the superficial veins into the deep veins through the perforators, there'll be a backflow of blood. So from the deep vein, it will backflow and it will pull at the extremities, causing swelling, okay, and distension, and that's when you get varicosities. So what happens with the pooling of blood here? Number one, with the pressure, some of the blood will leak out, okay, and you have RBCs. So the RBCs will break down, and one of the products would be hemosiderin. So hemosiderin will cause a brownish discoloration at the lower, the distal leg and the shin. It causes a brownish discoloration, and the pooling of the blood can trigger some inflammation, and that will cause venous eczema or ulceration as well. And you also have fibrotic. With prolonged inflammation, you have fibrosis and contraction, which will cause narrowing of the lower limb, and that is what we refer to as lipodermatosclerosis. So these are the findings that we will be applying in the examination later. So just understand this basic principle so that when in examination we use these terms, perforators, you know what they refer to. Okay, so today we'll see varicose vein examination. So we'll start with inspection, palpation, auscultation, and
special test.
Okay. So what do? We first approach the patient, and ideally, because after greeting, introduction, basic courtesy, we would like to ideally expose the patient from umbilicus below. But for the modesty of the patient, we would like him to wear an undergarment. So he needs adequate exposure because we want to look at this proximal thigh, okay, all those things visible. But for this video purpose, we'll just maintain patient's modesty. Remember, he should ideally just be wearing an undergarment or, you know, a sarong which is just rolled up to the proximal thigh. Okay, so now we'll do with the inspection on the supine patient. So just inspect at the medial aspect and lateral aspect, anterior aspect of the lower limb. Look for any evidence of varicosities or tortuous dilated veins. Just inspect. Okay, so a general idea, if you find varicosities above the knee level, it indicates involvement of the long saphenous vein system. If you find varicosities below the knee, it could be either long or short saphenous vein involvement. Then we would want him to stand, inspection with the patient standing. Okay, so make sure you show, okay, showmanship is important. Squat, okay, squat and inspect. What we will do here is, so the moment the patient stands, the feeling, okay, the varicosities will be more obvious. So when the patient stands, you will notice that the varicosities become more prominent. Okay, so this is just to get an anterior view. So you have to inspect anteriorly, okay, the lower limb anteriorly, medially, laterally, and posteriorly. Make sure you don't leave any dimensions away. So what will you inspect? For the first thing, comment on the varicosities. Talk about extent. For example, just as a figure of speech, so it's extending from the distal part of the
So use any surface anatomy like
basic surface anatomy, yes.
Indexing into the distal part or lateral, all those things.
Yes, lateral, distal. Just play with those words, okay? Anteromedial. Mm-hmm. You know, example from the medial aspect of the distal leg, and it extends above the knee and inserts at the anteromedial part of the proximal thigh, for example. Just play along with the word, okay? Medial, lateral, anterior, anteromedial, okay? Proximal, mid, distal.
Okay.
It's here, it's thigh, it's leg. Okay, leg means only from knee to ankle. The whole thing is called lower limb. So don't overlap with the layman term of leg, which refers to the entire lower limb. Okay, then what else do you inspect for?
Scars.
Look for scars which can indicate previous surgery. Look for any swelling indicative could be indicative of deep vein thrombosis. Look for hemosiderin staining, okay, which is brownish discoloration. Look for any venous eczema.
Lipodermatosclerosis.
Look for lipodermatosclerosis, which we saw earlier. Okay, there will be contracture, okay, and scarring, fibrosis. Okay, and look for redness, which can indicate thrombophlebitis. And make sure you look for any venous ulcers. It will be usually around the malleoli. So if you find any ulcer, make sure you do the inspective comment on inspection for ulcer. You can check on the link below that we have given the way to describe an ulcer using diabetic foot ulcer as an example. So what must you inspect on an ulcer, which applies to all ulcers? So you can describe, okay? So you can, what can you describe? Number, size, shape, age, margin and floor of the ulcer. So age of the margin is the mode of communication between the floor and the margin. Edge could be punched out or sloping. Usually venous ulcer will have a sloping edge. Okay, margin is, okay, maybe it's well demarcated or not well demarcated. Floor is the exposed part of the ulcer. Okay, so is it filled with granulation or is it filled with slough, etc. Okay, then we come to palpation of the inspection. So what do we palpate? We palpate on the tortuous veins, on the varicosities. So where? Distal to proximal. Okay, so you just, let's just, okay, just imagine varicosities, okay, extending from the medial aspect of the lower limb. So you just palpate. Okay, just palpate. What do you look for? You mentioned for any blowouts. Okay, so upon the palpation, I can feel blowout at the
balloon-like swelling. Yeah,
balloon-like swelling. You feel like balloon-like swelling. So palpate for any blowouts and mention. Okay, always mention surface anatomy. As I said, always play the words. Okay, distal, proximal. Okay, mid. Medial, lateral, anterior, posterior also. Okay, and the amalgamation of both, anteromedial, anterolateral, posterolateral, posteromedial, etc. Then you also palpate if there's any tenderness. It can come in
thrombophlebitis.
Tenderness can be present in thrombophlebitis, particularly in the area of redness in which you inspected for. So always make sure that you look at a patient's face or you palpate, look for grimace indicative of tenderness. You also palpate for edema. Okay, palpate for edema.
TVL.
Okay. TVL, okay. Edema, look for, or edema swelling, right? Edema. Okay, and then you, for auscultation, you auscultate for femoral bruit. Then we come to the special test, which is the most important component. So number one, we want to do single tourniquet test, which is to look for the incompetence of the saphenofemoral junction. Okay. So what do we do? The first thing is, we elevate. Okay, elevate and ideally ask the chaperon to hold the elevated limb so you can access it. Okay, kirti. Okay. Then you milk the vein. Let's say this is a dilated tortuous vein, okay, varicosity. You milk it distal to proximal. Okay, milk everything. Milk the content. And then you tie a tourniquet just below the saphenofemoral junction. Okay, so where's the landmark for the saphenofemoral junction?
Is it 4 cm below?
Yeah, so pubic tubercle. So you palpate for the pubic tubercle first. Okay, so you start from here on palpation. So you'll get a pubic symphysis. Okay, so just approximately, let's say you're palpating like this and you get a hard consistency. Okay, so the middle finger lies on the pubic symphysis bone, symphysis pubis bone, and the index and ring finger are lying on the pubic tubercle. So pubic tubercle, it's, you can use your measuring tape, 4 cm inferior and 4 cm lateral. okay, to the pubic tubercle. That's why your femoral junction lies. So you want to tie the tourniquet just below the saphenofemoral junction. So imagine this is elevated, right? So, and imagine a chaperone, you don't have one. So you have to hold, someone needs to hold this and you tie. So that is the SFJ junction. Then you ask the patient to stand. So when you stand, you should notice that there shouldn't be any filling of the veins. Means there shouldn't be any reappearance of the varicosity. Remember, when we put him supine, we milked the vein, right? We milked it distal to proximal. So then we tied the tourniquet just below the SFJ junction. Then when we ask him to stand, so if there's no filling, it means that there is SFJ incompetence. So you release the tourniquet. So with the moment you release the tourniquet, should you notice filling proximal to distal, it means it confirms that there's a SFJ incompetency. Also, the moment you tie, the moment you tie the tourniquet below the SFJ and you made him stand, let's say there was no refilling until you untied the tourniquet, it also means that there is no perforator incompetence. Because if the perforators were already incompetent, there will be refilling even without me untying the tourniquet. So me looking for the refilling, the moment I remove the tourniquet indicates that the incompetence is just above the site in which I tie the tourniquet. Okay, so simple logic, the tourniquet is just basically preventing refilling, and the moment I release it, it fills up. Okay, it means the valve is incompetent, so there's a gravitation of the blood. Then you want to do multiple tourniquet tests. Right away. So let's say you want to look for perforator incompetence. What do you do? Same step, elevate, milk, okay, that's what we saw. But you're going to tie multiple tourniquet. So one just below the SFJ, okay, one above the knee, one below the knee, and one tourniquet above the ankle. And look at the refilling. So the site in which the refilling or the reappearance of the varicosities happen is where the incompetence is. So for Perti's test, you do the same step as what you did for single tourniquet test. Elevate, ask a chaperone to hold, milk the vein, distal to proximal, and then you tie the tourniquet just below the SFJ. And then you ask the patient to walk tiptoe for 3 minutes. Ask the patient to just walk tiptoe. For 3 minutes, just walk around.
Okay. Pain.
For 3 minutes. Mm. The patient feels pain within 3 minutes over the lower limb, then it indicates that it is deep pain thrombosis.
Okay.
Deep pain thrombosis. And then when you want to complete the examination, make sure that you mention that you would ideally like to perform an abdominal examination to look for any possibility of venous compression. Signs of venous compression, okay, by abdominal examination. Okay, so additional points, when you're taking a history, make sure you don't forget to ask the important risk factors. So what are the risk factors? You know, varicose, okay, limb, and what do we usually think of?
Age.
Occupation.
Age,
okay. Usually if someone who's standing very long, okay, where do you see? You can see, right, you're from Penang.
Yes.
You would have seen varicosities in hawkers.
Definitely.
Yeah. So name one hawker famous, where do you go in Penang?
Oh, Siam Road, Chakwek, yeah.
So it's not just about occupation, okay? It's age, family history, occupational hazard. That's where, okay, occupational hazard is where long standing. Usually in Malaysia, you can find that in hawkers. Females, pregnancy, during pregnancy, obesity, all these are risk factors. So make sure you don't forget to ask these points. Investigation. So the first thing you mention is make sure you try to talk about Doppler or duplex ultrasound scanning. To look for the extent of the varicose vein, and also to look for the competence of the deep veins. Number two, you want to do an ankle brachial index. So where else do we do ankle brachial index?
Definitely for ortho.
Mm-hmm.
In cases like
diabetic foot ulcer.
Yeah.
Mainly we want to look for peripheral, we want to rule out peripheral arterial disease. We'll come to that later. So ABI is very important. You want to check, do the ankle brachial index to see if the value, if it's normal or high or low. If it's usually below 1, then it is indicative of peripheral arterial disease. And surgical indications. So what are the surgical indications? You can do conservative management and surgical intervention. So what is the indication for surgery?
I mean, if according to priority, the cosmesis will come way down, but
probably, yeah.
The main thing is EDL, people who are having difficulty due to that.
So yeah, if you have symptoms which is affecting your activities of daily living, for example, aching, sensation of dragging, heaviness, cramping, restlessness,
unable to do work and everything, yes. Whatever.
Burning sensation, discomfort, if it's affecting your activities of daily living. Now, of course, like you said, cosmesis, it's an answer that you will always stick in your head. Cosmesis, let's say you're doing modeling, okay? You can't have a disfigured lower limb, right? With the varicosities, it wouldn't look very presentable or it wouldn't look sightly. So, cosmesis is also an indication. Recurrence. So, if the ulcer, let's say varicosities keep recurring and it ulcerates, what is the risk of ulceration? It can get into marginal ulcer, which is cancerous, yes. Okay, squamous cell carcinoma. So remember, that's a risk that we were wanting to avoid. The recurrence, not of ulceration, it can eventually become cancerous. Okay. And then, of course, lipodermatosclerosis,
scarring,
contracture. All this, in a way, can be a risk factor for compartment syndrome as well.
Okay.
Fibrosis, right? Fibrosis and a narrowing of space. Bleeding, of course, bleeding is also an indication. That's surgical intervention. So conservatively, how can you manage varicosity? So we saw risk factors, pregnancy. Let's say it happens during pregnancy. What do? You basically
watchful
waiting until post delivery. So you don't really do anything. Then compression socks. This is why it's important to take ABI. If you want to do compression stocking, you cannot do it if there's peripheral arterial disease.
Mm.
So before, that is why it's important to make sure, because you can't give any compression.
Yeah.
Right?
It's already compressed. Ischemic. Heading to it.
Yeah, you're going to worsen the ischemia. Reduction of weight, exercise, and elevation of lower limb. This comes under conservative management.